Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. So we'll talk about the transcatheter treatment of complete interruption or almost interruption, similar to what Mario said. But the most important, you have to be familiar with all the equipment. And I think one important is just to be slow and careful and watch all your aspect, what you do. So we are talking about severe coarctation. This is not for infant or, you know, small baby. This is for older age group, you know, adolescents and adult. Long-standing coarctation, unfortunately, that is still having missed by pediatrician because, or, and us sometimes, because we don't feel the femoral artery. So femoral artery examination is very important. In the past, usually was treated surgically. Also now, most of the surgeons, they try to shy away from this kind of surgery and they push the interventionists to do it. Okay, there is few cases has been reported, and I think Mario and other has reported a couple of cases. We collect our experience, and we put also some other. We get some cases from Shaq and Ziad, and we have a total of 9 cases. And the aim is to do the reconstruction, how we could do it, and what's way, and how it is become feasibility and safety and effectiveness, and to be simple and straightforward procedure. Now, as we said, we have a total of 9 patients. All of them done perforated and covered stent. These are the demographic data. So the age is the lowest was 13, and the body weight was the smallest is 52. Okay, most of all of these patients was diagnosed because it's ended that they have systemic hypertension, and they went to treatment and antihypertensive failure. And then all of a sudden was noted that the femoral pulse weak, and this was the diagnosis. 60%, they have bicuspid aortic valve, so this is possible that when you see a bicuspid aortic valve by echo, suspect a coarctation. Some have a small ASD, and some had a small VZ that insignificance. We do, of course, comprehensive clinical exam, ECG, X-ray, echo, CT, MRI, and then to the cath lab. And here you can see, this is just a plain X-ray where you can see rib notching clearly, massively on the, you know, left and right side. So also plain X-ray is important. And echo, this is just to show you that the echo should be also important. This loop is not working. Here is also Doppler that you see before that it was very damp, and you have to make sure that, you know, especially in adult, sometimes it's difficult to do, you know, suprasternal notch because they are not clear and it's not like small baby. Here's just a picture of CT scan, and they can show you nicely where is the lesion, how far, distance measurement. This is, you can do the 3D rendering, and I think this can move here. So you can just see where it is location. It gives you some idea how is it located and where is it, how far is from the left subclavian. Also, the ultimate thing is the cardiac cath. So actually, not all of these patients done under general anesthesia. Some under local, most of them under general anesthesia. Heparinization is important, antibiotic. We recommend that to have another access. Without it, it is very difficult. So you have to have an upper access. So one is radial, the other one transeptal. It's also a good, and of course the femoral, so you can do. We do, I will just show you. And we use the broken prose transeptal needle. You can use other things like, you know, radio frequency or laser perforations or, you know, the CTO. We haven't tried those, but the problem, these are, you know, sometimes you go in a very poor area that they don't have these facilities, and the transceptor is available everywhere. And it is, we think it is safe. Now, this here just show you injection from above, and then we do simultaneous injection later on below, so you see what is, it's completely occluded, again here, on the lateral projection. So we inject from above and then later below to see how much distance between the upper segment and the lower segment. Okay, and here we bring is the transeptal sheet, and we place it in, make sure that you are opposing the left upper part. Okay, you can put a big tail so it can give you a marker. And next here, sometimes you have to be careful. Sometimes you go outside, and in this case, for example, we went outside, but most of the time it was localized because, yeah, this is very important, Joe. You have to shape the transeptal. So that's important. This we done with an adult, and he just pushed it faster. I mean, I blame myself because I wasn't able to hold his hand, but it's very important to shave the transseptal. And you don't have to put the, you can only use a sheath and the dilator, and you just have to shave it because it has a curve. So you have to shave it to be, and the shape is depend on the, you know, how is the upper part and lower part. You can shave it differently. Okay, we got here, and here you can see, you know, when you shave, you put a contrast, you can see that you went above, and there is some contrast above the, yeah, so you can see it clearly here. So you can see it clearly here above, just a little contrast, and you can see the one. After that is really straightforward. You can push, you don't push the transseptal needle, only the sheath, the dilator only. So you can just advance the dilator only, little bit, just a little bit. Then put a wire, you can use a PTCA wire, you push it in so it doesn't cause any injury. Then you put the catheters, which you can use a small catheter, you know, like Jatkin 4. Then you put your only, then after that it is straightforward. We just put, we don't dilate. We just go in with the catheters. Then put, you know, the stiff wire. Then we put the sheet. We have never done any dilatation with balloon or BTCA. And we find it is once you put the stiff wire with the sheet, usually it's passed straightforward. After that, as Mario say, so it is simple. This is another one. See, there's no much resistance, just because of time. We have to be as fast as you're able to put your, you know, cover the stent. Our driver has to take us to the airport. I'm not sure it'll be good. Then we have just to put the stent in. You know, you do an upper injection. You'll be slow. And one more important things, I find that it is always good to do more. In stenting, it is, don't be, you know, shy of injection. Injection can give you more understanding. Take your time. Don't rush. In this situation, you don't need to be fast because it's almost atratic. You open, so you are relaxed. You don't have to do an overdrive basing. You just make sure you don't cover the left subclavian. That's the most important part because these are covered stent, and we have not used brain. Most of our stent are covered. Make sure that the left subclavian, you don't cover it because sometimes you get a coarctation at the left subclavian, and it will be difficult to get it out. So these are the inflation, inner outer balloon, and these are the injection there. Just after that is straightforward here, just because we want to show that have we the left subclavian, it was okay or not, and you can see it is patent. You can, because sometimes when you deploy the stent, when you do injection, the arch of the aorta is not clear. This here, the final angiogram for these patients. Okay, we'll go next for another patient. This patient here, we went and we did the transseptal approach, and you can see that we put a catheter across, and also what kind of catheter and these things, whatever we have available. So this is just a Jatkin right catheter. We're able to put it across the, you know, the perforated septum, went up to the aorta, and we're injecting from lower down. And we can see another one here that, again, with the needle, we try. Sometimes you have to be careful not to go into false tract. If you go into false tract, you have to come back again and go into the right place. See, we are not into, and you have to dig. Sometimes the distance are far, so you need to advance it further. And here, see, we are not into the right track. We have to, we came back, and we have to get it, shave it better. Finally, and you pass through, and then that's it. Once you pass through, you put your PTCA wire, and then advance catheter, advance wire, advance the sheet, put the stent. I'll just show you the final result. And here are the final results. So usually good. We don't usually, I mean, these are small. Usually the arch are not big, so we don't usually overinflate. So usually there will be little waste. We have a follow-up. I will talk about this. So mostly we use, all of them we use covered stent. We have never used any like self-expandable stent. And we have, I mean, the procedure time sometimes long, especially because some of this cath lab we have done is a single plane, so you have to go left and right, do transseptal. So of course is a little bit long. The fluoroscopy is reasonably. Most of the patients discharge, and we have not had a complication, vascular or death or anything. These are just the follow-up of the blood pressures before and after, and interestingly, the diastolic is blood pressure is extremely, you know, positive p-value, but the systolic wasn't that much. Some of these patients are still on antihypertensive medications. We have been about 4 years follow-up, and the gradient has been the same. Okay, there is still some that on antihypertensive medications, and they have two that we repeat catheters. One of that patients we haven't able to dilate because we haven't have enough balloon in the cath lab, so bring him in 6 months, we dilate it because the balloon was not, the biggest balloon was 12, so we have to redilate it again, and the other one was perfectly normal. Actually, that one with the transseptal was a medical student, 25 years old. So, and the follow-up, the New York Heart Association will come down. So just to conclude, Mr. Chairman, we think that this is a reasonable approach, that you can do the transseptal or you can do the laser perforation for, you know, functional aortic atresia. And we think that the follow-up for 4 years was good for us. Thank you very much for your attention.